Anna and the Apocalypse is a 2017 comedy musical zombie film set around the Christmas holiday. The director is John McPhail, whilst the writers are Alan McDonald and Ryan McHenry. The film follows Anna and her friends who get caught up in a zombie pandemic that is slaying its way through the UK during Christmas. With her father across the town, she must venture out and sing as well as dance her way to him. All the while, more than zombies begin to pose threats. Before unwrapping this film's plot, I should open up saying that I am not a huge fan of musicals. Generally, I find them rather annoying. However, there are two musicals I rather enjoy, that being the 2015 and 2016 TV show Gallivant.
But she is not the only thing I desperately want to do. I want to shoot him with the crossbow. I want to stab him in the eye. I want to liberate his head from his neck and then punt the bloody wreck sky high. I want to hurl him out a window and shove explosives where the sun don't shine.
And the 1974 rock musical horror comedy written by Brian De Palma, Phantom of the Paradise, which, yes, will be appearing on the channel one day.
The story of a sound, the man who created it. The girl who sang it, the monster who stole it, and the phantom who haunts the paradise, the ultimate rock palace.
So now that we know what kind of musicals I enjoy, let's get down to business and see if this is a gift worth giving. We open up with Anna Shepherd, played by Ella Hunt, her father Tony Shepherd, played by Mark Benton, and finally her friend John, played by Malcolm Cumming. They're all driving along when the radio comes on with some eerily threatening news.
The Center for Disease Control has recategorized the pandemic, first thought to be a supervirus strain of the flu. It has now been determined to be a lethal pathogen, seemingly capable of
Thanks, Anna. That was getting a little close to reality. Our first bit of trouble starts up when John lets slip that Anna is looking to buy a ticket that will get her out of Scotland for a bit, something that her father did not know.
I'm going on a trip, all right?
When? Where?
Dad.
Well, I hope you check when university starts, because...
I'm not going to uni!
Thank goodness this was a small Scotland town, or he could have caused an accident. Following on from that, we meet a number of characters, namely Brienne of Tarth, Teen Edition, aka Step North. That second name wasn't a Game of Thrones joke. Played by Sarah Swire. One of the better characters in this film, Arthur Savage, played by Paul Kaye, enters the scene. He's not a fan of Step writing about the homeless due to the person it would shine a bad light on being the person who funds the school. We then get our first of several songs that isn't bad, it's just meh, and in my opinion, very forgettable. I actually forgot this song was in here until the time of writing this review. One thing of note is that we get our first look at Nick, played by Ben Wiggins. The song is about breaking away, which is sang by three of our introduced characters. It fits for Anna, and to an extent, Step. But we know nothing about John, so his role here is a bit out of left field. As the song concludes, we meet a bulb of energy called Lisa, played by Marli Siu. Arthur comes in to make it more obvious he's on the naughty list. Also, we get an entertaining bit of foreshadowing.
Now where is my magician?
Here, sir!
I think it's about time we had a little chat about health and safety.
But what about the zombies? At lunch, we meet Chris Wise, played by Christopher Leveaux, whose relationship we figure out before even hearing his name.
Hey, guys.
Yay, boyfriend!
Seems Step needs Chris's help with a video she wants to make to bypass Arthur and tell the story of the homeless. But Lisa is going to have a major role at the Christmas party that night, to which Chris assures her that he'll make it. We also get a bit of a dilemma for John, where Anna basically says he isn't strong. Then another song, only this time with a lot more extras.
Love's not like the books, the films, or the song. We've been living a life for far too long.
It's the same as the first song in terms of quality and memorability. The only reason I recall this being the first song of the movie by accident is that I remembered a bit of choreography.
Such thing as a Hollywood ending.
Overall, I didn't like it, nor would I suggest it. After that old song and dance, we get a bit of drama between Anna and Step, with the latter being upset over a number of things and bringing up that Anna doesn't have a mother that hates her. Hint, her mom is dead. Also, first appearance of a zombie. Not exactly the head turn from Resident Evil. Later that night, we get this.
My favorite dish is fish, mother flipper, and I eat it for the hell of it. A nice bit of halibut. That's not the only fish they got. Mackerel.
Well, that's a thing. Finally, we get a good song in this film that I rather enjoy, for a few reasons.
There's a lack of presence in my stocking, and my chimney needs a good unblocking.
And Arthur is warming up to me.
What graphic, salacious. I'm going to kill her.
Add in an oi, and another zombie hint makes this a highlight of the film. Shame Chris isn't here.
Captain Wesker, where's Chris?
At the bowling alley, John proves he's a shoo-in for a manslaughter charge.
John, wait.
The next day, Anna wakes up and we get a musical version of that oblivious scene in Shaun of the Dead. And so at the 26th mark, we get some zombie action. The song is better than the first two, but also not very memorable, though the comedy is alright. We end on Anna and John meeting up at the most dead place. Our first zombie appears in the form of Frosty.
I'm a first aider. I'm just going to turn you over.
Some clever use of the environment leads to a gory kill, and then they drop the Z word.
Anna. That guy's a zombie.
At the school, we find a handful of characters hiding out with Arthur, trying to calm everyone. Meanwhile, at the bowling alley, our main group unites and consult the internet for answers. Along with answers, we also get to see what people would probably really do. I can't wait to see what Rule 34 does. A bit later, Step gets to pull off a kill with some Game of Thrones gore. Then we get a zombify Total Recall moment. A brief fight breaks out, with at least one memorable kill. Once night falls, both groups encounter a problem as the power station for the town seems to blow up, stranding them in darkness. We get another song that is once again forgettable and bland. Oh, and the army got wiped. Wanting to escape, they use basically the same tactic as in Tremors 3.
This is the stupidest idea ever.
This doesn't go too well.
Yeah, an old woman sitting on your face.
Oh.
Huh. I guess being turned into a zombie slows down our body's decay, as normally that happens 24 to 47 hours after death. Help comes in the form of Nick and his posse. This leads to one of the better and at least somewhat memorable songs.
Ladies, why don't you get behind me? Yeah, groovy.
Has a bit of an 80s rock vibe to it, and the scene is somewhat enjoyable to watch. Ends pretty well as well. Back at school, everyone is prepping to leave, but Arthur doesn't want that to happen. Cutting back to our main group, you'd think, with four adept zombie killers, you'd think they'd be doing pretty well. Well, after John gets the best friend speech, they cut through a store and half of them get bodied by elf zombies. With all the cannon fodder gone, it's John's time to get bit. Suddenly, zombies appear from everywhere despite everyone else walking in before John. With a bit of a cry, they leave John, and I don't feel any loss for him. In what I suppose is a rage-fueled badass scene, they fight their way to the school and encounter Arthur, who has the best line so far.
What are you doing?
I'm eating my Christmas dinner, Miss North.
Letting them in, Arthur locks them in a room filled with undead. Oh, and if you couldn't tell, he's the bad guy.
I can't wait to show your daddy what's left of you.
Savage, please, 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 no!
Arthur gets his own song, which isn't bad and is mostly entertained through Paul acting like he's lost it, or has been sampling snow of a different kind.
All my life they told me I would never succeed. Put me down, controlled me, made me follow their lead. Bought their lives, they sold me for too long, but now I'm finally free.
Somehow, by poking the gate, they're able to escape and pursue the madman. It then grinds to an absolute stop as they split up and explore the building. To save some time, I'll jump around here. Chris finds Lisa. Anna and Nick have a nice chat. Chris and Lisa become zombies while Step and Nick are running around doing something on their own. Finally, Anna confronts Arthur, who has her father, and it basically becomes a Dead Rising 2 boss fight.
How on earth are you still alive? Showing off, I see. Quite the leading lady, aren't we?
The song and choreography here is some of the best in the film, and while I won't remember the lyrics by the next hour, I did have a decent time watching it and hearing the back and forth between our hero and villain.
I'll do all I can before I go to my grave. There's good on this earth and it's worth trying to save.
Well, Miss Shepherd, you're so wrong, you don't have a clue. A purge on this species is long overdue. All humanity's broken, our story is done. As the set catches fire, might as well have some fun.
There's even a bit of style with how she takes the stage. Despite the fact they could simply back up, Anna's father and Arthur get into a fight, and remember that foreshadowing?
Dad!
He even went out like a Dead Rising boss. Sadly, during the fight, Anna's father was bitten and she is forced to leave. Step pulls up in her vehicle and the remaining three survivors drive off with that second song from the start. All in all, this trip was a massive net loss. On the bright side, we go out with a rather nice little animated credit sequence. So that was Anna and the Apocalypse. Thankfully, there is an encore. Look, while I may not particularly like a genre, that doesn't mean a film from said genre can't be something I will like. Look no further than Phantom of the Paradise for musicals or Cinema Woman for dramas. This is a film that seems to have its heart in the right place but just doesn't work. I don't care about any of the characters, most of the deaths are rather stupid, and none of the songs are great. The setup of the story is fine, and I like that we get to watch the father's group situation even if it is brief, and Arthur's breakdown happens rather rapidly. I just didn't care if any of the characters lived or died, as I mostly found them boring and too one note. The best character was Arthur, and Nick, the former just for being crazy and fun, but the latter has a nice character arc, going from the jerk-off jock character to a decent guy over the course of the film. The songs were mostly bad with only three highlights, that being Lisa's song, Nick's song, and the final fight song, however I wouldn't go as far as to say I'd listen to them in my free time. They're okay compared to the rest and come out on top, but I'll take other music over theirs. While this is a comedy, it did make me laugh a little, I got a chuckle here and there, but nothing came close to even the worst joke in Shaun of the Dead. I will say that the gore effects were okay, again nothing too memorable with only the one bowling alley death sticking with me. While I couldn't find a budget, the film did make a worldwide gross of $673,523, with its opening weekend making $52,588. The film is pretty much universal with its title, with only an alternative German title being very different. This alternative title is Anna and the Apocalypse, a Zombie High School Musical. The film first appeared in the USA on 22nd September 2017 at Fantastic Fest. On the 30th of November 2018, it got a limited release here in the States. The last showing of the film was in Sweden during 25th of October 2019 at Gothenburg Film Festival Prisma. Its filming was primarily done in Port Glasgow, Scotland. There are three versions of the film, the US version at 93 minutes, the UK theatrical at 98 minutes, and a director's cut at 108 minutes. The version I reviewed was the 93 cut, but from what I've been able to find, it doesn't seem much was removed for the US release. The film was nominated for a few awards, but didn't win any. At the end of the film, we get a dedication to Ryan McHenry, who passed away in 2015. He was responsible for writing and directing the short film Zombie High School, which was a short film that was later turned into Anna and the Apocalypse. The man playing the keyboard at Lisa's stage performance is Tommy Riley, who co-wrote the music for the film. When looking at the selfies, one of the users is named Ash Campbell, which is a mixture of Ash Williams and Bruce Campbell. You can also see the film's art director, Martin Kelly. There was originally going to be a full musical scene with a drunk Santa and several extras who would be zombified later. However, due to poor weather conditions, it was cut. I think this might have been the same Santa that ends the film with a jump scare. One scene that is cut from both US and UK versions is a song performed by Mark Benton and Paul Kaye called Which Side Are You On? It was cut due to pacing issues and is only viewable on the Blu-ray director's cut. The shopping center scene was filmed at the abandoned Freeport Shopping Village just outside Livingston, Scotland. The school was St. Stephen's High School in Inverclyde, Scotland, which was destroyed in 2019. That snow angel scene was done with fake snow, but it was winter. The lady at the bowling alley is called Miss Hintzman, which is a nod to the actor who killed Johnny in the original Night of the Living Dead, Bill Hintzman. Both the hula girl in Anna's dad's car and the car itself were used in another film called Beats. You may not recognize him here, but Paul Kaye played Thoros Amir on Game of Thrones. So would I suggest this film? No, I found it boring, forgettable, and at best it wasn't too annoying. Perhaps some theater students would enjoy this film, but I couldn't find enough to enjoy it. I wouldn't even suggest this as a Christmas film. Perhaps you could find someone to give this movie to as a gift, but I'd like a receipt so I can return it.
And now, folks, it's time to say goodnight. We sincerely appreciate your patronage and hope we've succeeded in bringing you an enjoyable evening of entertainment. Please drive home carefully and come back again soon. Good night.